Hi, in this video I will show you how to use our system to teach permanent magnet DC motors as well as DC motor drives. The system will use a lead acid battery pack to power the motor. We will also use the 4-quadrant dynamometer power supply, first to drive the generator, and then when we study the motor, we will use it in the power supply mode to be able to apply a variable power supply to the motor itself. The dynamometer will need to be mechanically coupled to the permanent magnet machine using the supplied timing belt. To do that, you will need to open the front panels and place the timing belt between the machines. You will notice that on the permanent magnet machine, the machine is not centered. This is because since the shaft, the gear on the shaft is smaller, it needs to be to the right of the machine. We will use this spring-loaded mechanism to put more tension on the belt itself. So you will need to place your belt between the machines like this. And then make sure that your belt passes between the tensioning bearings like this. The student manuals are very important with that system. They feature theory as well as step-by-step procedures in very details. Turn the machine on, connect this, turn this to that amount, and so on. It will also ask students to do measurements and explain why they do get those measurements. On top of the student manual, you also have an instructor guide that contains all of the answers to the questions asked to the students, and a user guide that explains how to use the system in general and in detail how you would use the data acquisition software. The first exercise will explain to students the important concepts of speed, torque, and mechanical power. To do so, they will use the 4-quadrant dynamometer. To use it, you need to make sure that you are in the dynamometer mode. Then you can change the function by pressing on the function button. For example, now I see that it is a 2-quadrant constant torque brake. And the quantity that is blinking is my actual quantity that I'm controlling. So in that case, that would be the torque. If I change it, for example, for a prime mover, meaning that I want to drive my machine, that would be a generator, then I would select that mode here. If I control the speed and I press start, then the machine starts rotating. I can stop then. I could go to counterclockwise, I could go to constant speed prime mover, and so on. Many modes are available and they're all explained in the student manuals. In the second exercise, they will study the permanent magnet DC machine as a generator. To do that, they will use the dynamometer in prime mover mode and change the speed of rotation. They would also need a general purpose multimeter, although they could also connect into the data acquisition, and they will use that to monitor the voltage and the current that is available in the machine. So if I connect, for example, directly on the machine here, I put it in voltage mode. When I make the machine turn, I will see that the actual voltage depends on the speed that my motor goes to. So more speed basically gives me more voltage. In the third exercise, they will study the permanent magnet DC machine as a motor. To do that, in order to have a variable power supply to apply to it, we will use the dynamometer in the power supply mode. We will use it as a voltage source, so you can control your DC voltage here. And we will connect the variable power supply directly on the motor itself. Since we will be interested in knowing the actual speed of the machine when we apply more or less voltage to it, we will need to connect the shaft encoder outputs of the dynamometer directly into the data acquisition unit, so we can, on the computer screen, see the actual speed, torque, mechanical power, and other interesting values. Let's now check how to do the connections on the data acquisition unit. So first, I will need to bring the speed into the data acquisition. In order to do that, you will need smaller leads that are supplied with the system. They did supply smaller leads, so you cannot, by mistake, connect power leads into the lower voltage connections. So the shaft encoder output A will go into the encoder input A. The digital ground needs to be connected to the digital ground, and the shaft encoder B needs to be connected to B. If I wanted to see the voltage and current of my motor, I could take my power supply here and connect it directly to a voltmeter, for example, E1. And to see the current, instead of going straight on my motor, I would want to go through an ammeter. So I could put a jumper here from my positive power supply into an ammeter. And output of the ammeter into my DC motor. All of the steps are very well explained in the book. Don't hesitate to open the student manual and try the steps one by one. You will also need to bring power to the data acquisition and to connect a USB cable from your computer into the data acquisition. After that, you launch the LVDAC software. When you launch the LVDAC software, it should automatically detect what is connected on your USB port. In that case, I have a single data acquisition unit, but mine has all of the currently available functions inside it. Yours might be a bit smaller. If you don't see a list here, you should double check your connections and click refresh to make sure that you are effectively connected. Otherwise, you will see just a set of fixed measurements, not your actual measurements. So I click OK. And now I can look at my actual measurements into the metering, for example. So here I would need to click on the continuous refresh to see the actual values. So if I start my system, I can see the actual voltages and current. They should be set to DC though. And I can also see the speed that I would need to set speed to the encoder A and B in that case. I can also see the values on the oscilloscope, phasor analyzer, or harmonic analyzer, but in this case, it's not very useful because we are all working in DC values. The next book deals with DC motor drives. You will study the basic PWM DC motor drives, the bidirectional PWM motor drives with regenerative braking, and the speed feedback and current control in PWM DC motor drives. Basically, to connect the drives, you will need to connect your battery pack into the IGBT pack. So here I have my battery pack into my IGBTs on the DC bus. Depending on the exercise, an additional smoothing inductor might also be required. But for the basic ones, DC goes in and the output will go into my DC motor. So output from the IGBT into the motor here. I could go through a switch if I wanted to. Into the motor. And the return would go to the negative of the battery. Now to control the IGBT, the gate control will come from the data acquisition and control interface, and it will be controlled through the LVDAC software. So I will need to connect the gates on the data acquisition unit using one of the special cables supplied with it, which is just a 9 connector cable. If I want to take a look at the voltages and current, I can connect them directly on the power inputs here, 4 voltmeters, 4 ammeters. And if I want to look at the gate signal, I can use the smaller cables to go into the analog inputs. All of the nice pedagogical ways to look at that are explained in detail in the books. Now let's try to take a look at what happens when I start the actual control. After you launch the software, you will need to go into the data acquisition and control interface and select the chopper inverter control. In the case of the first exercise, the chopper that I want to use is a buck chopper, so I want to reduce the voltage. Directly in the settings here, I can control the duty cycle, the switching frequency, the acceleration and deceleration time as well. So if I start this and play with the duty cycle, by sending a higher average value to my motor, once the switch is on, I should be able to see the motor running. But only if I also bring the 24 volts power supply to the IGBT module. So, as you see, if I had followed the steps in the manuals, I would have seen that. So in my case, I will stop here the chopper, do the connection, and start again. The worst that could happen is that you would go into overcurrent if you try to go to a high speed at once. In that case, I want to stop here and maybe put some acceleration time to avoid going into overcurrent. Let's say I put 5 seconds for acceleration and 5 for deceleration. So it is stopped. All you need to do is reset the unit and start again. And we can see that in the dynamometer mode, the actual speed is 254 RPM. So if I put my 4-quadrant dynamometer into the dynamometer mode, into the brake mode, and I start my function here, I will monitor the actual speed, and I can also apply a braking torque. Let's say I start at 0 and slowly increase that torque. I can see my mechanical power, and I can also see that the torque changed and the speed changed until a point where if I apply too much torque, I should be able to go into overcurrent. The other modes that the course will explore are the regenerative braking by using a buck boost chopper, and also a drive that would include feedback. So in that case, I would want a buck chopper with feedback. And I have access to the various parameters, the proportional gain, integral gain, filter, and so on. I also have a 4-quadrant DC motor drive without current control, and a 4-quadrant DC motor drive that would include current control as well, which in fact is a PI that is controlling another PI in cascade mode. So in summary, all of the connections and measurements are very easy to do if you follow the steps in the books. But if you try to just guess it by yourself, you will probably have a very hard time figuring it out. So at first, before the students walk in, just take the time to try the exercise by reading step by step, 1, connect this, 2, turn the switch on, and so on. And you shouldn't have any problem with that.